Welcome to Animals Today, your home for serious talk about animals. I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. Recently, another big story in our understanding of animal language was published, this one having to do with dolphins. Now, we all know about how smart dolphins are, and now there's research that they even have individual names. And I bet we are only scratching the surface on dolphin communication and language. Now, closer to home, how about our dogs? When one of my dogs anxiously cries and whines while driving in the car, and the other dog, who's usually calm, gets nervous because of that, does that represent a type of dog language? So I'm excited to be exploring the topic of communication and language on Animals Today with you with Dr. Slobodchikoff, Professor Emeritus, Department of Biology, Northern Arizona University in Flagstaff. Khan has dedicated his career to understanding language in non-human animals, with most of his research being on prairie dogs. The new book is titled Chasing Dr. Doolittle, Learning the Language of Animals. Welcome, Khan.
Thank you, Dr. Kirshner.
Khan, first of all, congratulations on your book, which we have been enjoying reading this at home, and you cover so many interesting ideas about animal communication and language of non-human animals, and also loads of interesting stories, and I think this book would really appeal to anyone who cares about nature and animals. So take a moment to get us going by explaining and distinguishing what you mean, Khan, by animal communication and animal language.
Sure. Communication is just simply sending and receiving messages. There is nothing beyond that. So a cell phone is a communication device. A normal telephone is a communication device. A computer could be a normal communication device. There's nothing going on between the sending and receiving of a signal. Language, on the other hand, involves much more than that. Linguists have 13 criteria that they say are important in identifying a language. And these are quite technical, and I won't go into those here. But basically, the way that I look at it is language has four essential criteria. One is flexibility, in the sense that the animal can produce many different kinds of signals to a particular kind of context. Another one is intentionality. The animal intends to communicate or produce a signal. Another one is novelty. The animal can make up new signals. So, for example, if we had talked about cell phones 50 years ago, nobody would know what we were talking about. And the last one is structure. So there is some kind of grammatical structure, some sort of structure in the way these signals are assembled. If you have all four of those criteria, that, in my terms, is language.
So interesting. Khan, in your book, you introduce a concept, the discourse theory. Can you explain that to us?
Sure. When I started thinking about language, basically, many scientists and many linguists said that language was something that was special to humans. No other animal has language. And I started thinking about this, and this really didn't make any sense to me, because when you look at, say, vertebrates, you see a continuity in all kinds of systems. We all have a skeletal system. We all have a circulatory system. We have a similar immune kind of system. Why not language? So I started to think about this and started to think that when you look at it from the standpoint that so many animals have in place all of the physiological and morphological systems that are necessary for language, so they have systems for production of sound or signals. They have neural systems in place for reception of these signals, translation of these signals. That if you look at it in that context, which I call the discourse system theory, then we have a huge continuity between us and other animals in terms of language and language production. And once we identify it from that standpoint in terms of the systems that we have for the production of language, then we can look at it from an evolutionary perspective that this is something that natural selection can act on.
Khan, how did you get interested in prairie dogs, and why do you find studying them so fascinating? And by the way, what is a prairie dog? It looks like a big, adorable rodent to me.
Well, that's essentially what a prairie dog is. A prairie dog is a rodent who's about a foot long, weighs about a couple of pounds, and they're social colonial animals. They live in colonies called towns. We used to have millions of prairie dogs. All five species of prairie dogs occur in North America, and we used to have millions of them. Now we're down to only about 1 to 2% of the numbers we had 100 years ago. So they're rapidly disappearing. But I became interested in prairie dogs because I wanted to study the social system of prairie dogs, which turns out to be fairly complex. They have territories within their towns, and we used to think that family groups occupied these territories. Now we know that in many cases it's groups of friends who actually collaborate with each other to defend the territorial boundaries, kind of like medieval villages. And in the process of studying the social behavior, I noticed that they had alarm barks for predators. And at one time, when I was thinking about this, I read a paper that said that other ground squirrels had two types of alarm barks, one for aerial predators, another one for ground predators like coyotes, badgers, and so on. So I thought it would be interesting to record prairie dog calls and see if they too have two different kinds of calls. I recorded the calls and found that, yes, you could separate it out that way, but there's still a lot of variation. And I started wondering, why is that variation there? And then had an insight, maybe that variation is descriptions or names for the individual species of predators, such as coyote or dog or human. And
okay,
once I started setting up experiments and recording for that and analyzing the variation collapsed for the most part. And so it is legitimate now to say that prairie dogs actually do have different words for different predators.
So, Colin, let's hear some prairie dog calls, which are fascinating because they have so much information in them, as you described. What are we going to play first?
We're going to play a coyote call first. Now, keep in mind that this is a bunch of chirps that are a tenth of a second long, and they're usually repeated with the same information in them.
Okay, so describe what we're hearing here.
So what we're hearing here is each chirp contains a number of frequency and time elements. If you put each chirp on something called a sonogram, which is a pictorial representation of frequency and time elements in a vocalization, it looks like a series of sergeant stripes going up to a peak and then coming down with a bunch of these things stacked one on top of each other. And within those, frequency and time elements change to provide the information that this is a coyote. Now, keep in mind, we're dealing with something that is a tenth of a second long, and yet within that tenth of a second, they are telling that it is a coyote.
Wow, fascinating. Let's hear another prairie dog call. What are we going to hear next?
We're going to hear calls for a domestic dog.
Okay, Con, describe what we just heard and what is its significance?
It sounds initially like calls to a coyote, and in fact, for many years, people thought that all alarm calls sounded the same. But when you actually listen to it and get out in the field, you can actually hear the differences between all of these calls. And so here again, we have a series of stacked sergeant stripes, but the frequency and time elements are different. So here they are now describing a dog rather than a coyote. Even though coyotes are similar to dogs, they invariably make that distinction.
Great. Now let's hear one more. This is the human call, correct?
Correct.
Okay. That sounded a little faster to me. Is that correct? Why is that noteworthy?
It really isn't that noteworthy in terms of how fast it is, because there's another element in how those chirps are repeated, and that is that the repetition of the chirps is directly correlated to the speed of travel of the predator. So if you listen to, say, calls to a human walking slowly, they're repeated slowly, and then as the human picks up speed, they tend to occur faster and faster and faster.
Very good. Don't go away. More with Dr. Khan Slobodchikoff right here on Animals Today. We're talking about communication in language with non-human animals. Hi, this is Dr. Lori Kirshner, and I want to thank you for listening to Animals Today. Make sure to visit us on animalstodayradio.com, where you will see all our previous shows, and you can download them free. That's animalstodayradio.com. Also, make sure to become a friend on Facebook. Animals Today gets a lot of its support from the nonprofit group Advancing the Interests of Animals. Check them out at aianimals.org. And I hope you'll consider making a donation to help pay for the ongoing broadcast of Animals Today. Each week on Animals Today, we strive to bring you the highest quality, most up-to-date information about all animal welfare topics, and we certainly would appreciate your support. That website again is aianimals.org. And thanks for listening.
As temperatures climb, please remember to never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute on a warm day with the windows cracked and in the shade. The temperature inside a car can climb up in a matter of minutes, and it's enough to kill your pet. If you love your pet, leave them at home or with someone you trust. Keep them cool, comfortable, and alive. And if you see a dog or other pet in a car, you may only have a moment to save their life. Here are a couple of steps that you should remember. Make an announcement in the store or business the car is parked nearest to, and call the police department or animal control right away. Remember, it only takes a minute or two on a hot day to kill an animal left inside a car. Your swift action can save a life. Dogs are unable to cool themselves the way people can. Never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at aianimals.org. That's the letter A, aianimals.org.
If you depend on prescription opioid painkillers or heroin to get through each day, you may ask yourself, how did I get here? Withdrawal and rehab seem like scary and difficult roads, but there is a different way. I know because I was just like you and I found it at turntohelpnow.com. At turntohelpnow.com, I learned about different ways to get help, including those in a private setting without the need for daily visits. Find your courage and go to turntohelpnow.com today.
Owe $10,000 or more to the IRS that you can't pay? Call now for immediate help. 866-657-8517. At Community Tax Relief, we help consumers like you. If you take on the IRS alone, you could be facing levies, liens, even wage garnishments, personal or business tax issues. If you owe the IRS $10,000 or more, they will aggressively come after you. Protect yourself and your family today from what the IRS can do to you. Call now, 866-657-8517. They can freeze your bank account, even garnish your wages. Our expert team of tax professionals can solve your tax problems once and for all. Call now for a free 5-minute tax debt analysis. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517.
The mills were overstocked, so they came to us. We struck incredible deals on incredible floors, and we're passing the deals on to you at Lumber Liquidators Overstock Flooring Sale. All bamboo is on sale for $1.49 a square foot. Get laminate flooring from 49 cents, and our best laminates up to 33% off. Pre-finished hardwood is up to 40% off our incredibly low prices, plus special extended financing. Overstock Flooring Sale is going on now. Get to LumberLiquidators.com or your local store for your big deal today.
The papers and the trash.
Don't
Welcome back to Animals Today. I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. We're speaking to Dr. Slobodchikoff, and we are listening to prairie dog calls, and he just explained to us what we heard in the last three calls. Con, what other kinds of information are encoded in these prairie dog calls?
As we were doing the experiments, I noticed that even for a particular predator, like, say, for a human or for a dog, there's still a lot of variation beyond the kind of variation we would expect for individual animals having their own voice print. And I started to think about why this variation occurs, and then sudden insight occurred that maybe they're describing the physical features of the individual predator. So we did a series of experiments with humans, with dogs, to find that prairie dogs are describing the physical features, say, of a human. They're describing the size and shape of the human. They're describing the color of clothes that the human is wearing. They're describing the size and shape of a dog. They're describing the coat color of a dog. So as we look at the prairie dog calls, we find that more and more they have a lot of sophisticated information, and we're just probably scratching the surface on that.
So what, if anything, can we learn or have we learned about communication between people by studying animal communication and language?
Well, very specifically here, I worked with a computer science colleague, and we used artificial intelligence techniques so that a computer could record the prairie dog alarm calls, analyze the structure of the calls, and then potentially spit back in English what is the meaning of the call. And then we could say something in English, and the computer could analyze this, put together a sound, and play it back to the prairie dogs as a meaningful message. And I think that what this opens the door to is that we now have the technology to be able to do comparable things so that we could communicate with our pets, like our dogs and cats, or perhaps farm animals. We could build software that could be, say, an app in our cell phone, and in this software, the dog could go bark, and the app would say, I want to eat chicken tonight. Or the cat could say, meow, and the app would say, clean out my litter box, please. And I think that this is really important because when you think about it, somewhere between 2 to 3 million animals are euthanized every year in shelters. And most of the time they're euthanized because of behavioral problems. And these behavioral problems occur because the animal cannot convey to the human its needs, and the human cannot convey to the animal their own needs. And so there's this misperception of what's going on, and the animal finds itself in a shelter and then is euthanized. If we had a way of communicating with animals, which I think we have if we get the necessary information, I think within 5 to 10 years we will be able to communicate at some basic level with animals that we're familiar with.
I love it. Con, in past decades, as we began studying animal language and communication, we taught captive primate sign language and also tried to teach animals how to vocalize human language. How do you put that work in perspective now?
The big problem with teaching animals human-generated language is that it takes a lot of effort to get the animals to learn some basic kinds of things. It would be sort of like somebody putting us in a completely novel situation and then asking us to learn something that was entirely foreign to us. Many animals don't have, like chimps, don't have vocal tracts that produce the kinds of sounds that we make. So my perspective is that I think that those studies are wonderful. I think that they open the door to looking at animal language, but I think that at this point, it's probably more productive to try to decode the natural languages that animals have rather than to try to teach them some kind of artificial system where there's a lot of frustration on the part of the animal and on the part of the teacher in terms of bringing the animal up to a point where some meaningful communication can take place.
Con, how about in terms of being more respectful and compassionate towards all animals, central ideas to the philosophy of this show? Where does improved understanding of language in non-human animals intersect with the animal rights movement? For instance, knowing that dolphins are extremely intelligent and that they have self-awareness, and now that they even have individual names, does not seem to counter the industry of confining dolphins in small tanks and enclosures for our amusement.
When I would talk to people about my work with prairie dogs, I would tell them about the ecology of prairie dogs, that prairie dogs are disappearing, and people's eyes would sort of glaze over. They've heard this message many times before with many other animal species. But when I would tell them that prairie dogs actually have a language that they use to communicate with each other, their eyes would open up. They would suddenly begin to empathize with animals, with prairie dogs. And my hope is that with this book, that this would open up people's eyes to start empathizing with lots of different animals, that there really isn't that much of a gap between us and the rest of the animals. And once people start empathizing with animals, they could see animals as living, thinking beings. Right now, I see a lot of people disconnected from nature. I see a lot of people disconnected from animals. If they think about animals at all, they think about animals as little robots running around on programs of instinct. They don't think, the animals don't think according to this view. They're just there. And if I can get across to people the idea that animals have language, they're not that different from us, then my hope is that this would lead to a much more respectful relationship between us humans and the rest of the natural world.
Well stated, Con. You also have a dog behavior blog. Do dogs have language as you define it?
Sure. We know surprisingly little, actually, about dogs and cats, and it's only been in the last 10 years or so that we've been getting information about dogs and cats. But as people have been getting information, we have found that there's a lot of information in dog barks. Dogs can bark identifying their people, for example. They can bark conveying information about they're wanting to play, about fearful types of situations. Cats can convey a lot of information, too. For example, cats have been shown to have at least 35 different kinds of vocalizations for different contexts. And then we also have all of the body signals that dogs have, such as wagging their tails. If dogs are happy, they tend to wag their tail more to the right than they do to the left. Cats close their eyes slowly and then open them slowly in a sign that essentially says, I love you. So all of these kinds of things, both the auditory signals and the visual signals, all combine into a language that is, in basic idea, relatively similar to what we have.
The book is Chasing Dr. Doolittle, Learning the Language of Animals by Dr. Con Slobodchikoff. Check out his website and Facebook, and we'll put the links so people can buy and enjoy your book. Con, thank you so much.
Thank you, Lori. Thank you for having me.
This is Dr. Lori Kirshner, and I want to thank you for joining us on Animals Today. Each week, we explore the wide variety of important issues concerning the welfare of animals, how people treat them, and where they fit in our society. From whale protectors on the open seas, to lawyers in court, to scouts helping their local shelter, join me to get the latest on animal welfare news, stories, and events from around the world. And visit us on Facebook to join the conversation. That's Animals Today every week right here on the station, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Also, make sure to visit us at animalstodayradio.com, where you can listen to any of our previous shows free. Animals Today brings you the highest quality, most up-to-date information about all animal welfare topics. Much of our support comes from the nonprofit group Advancing the Interests of Animals. Check them out at aianimals.org. That's aianimals.org. And thanks for listening.
If you're a Medicare member with diabetes, you may be confused over recent changes affecting where you can buy test strips. Don't worry. CVS Pharmacy continues to accept Medicare Part B coverage for diabetes testing supplies. Our stores carry all major brands and offer a 90-day supply at the same low Medicare copay as mail order. You may even qualify for a free one-touch or CVS brand meter from the manufacturer. So stop by your local CVS Pharmacy today.
Ah, the sweet sound of money in your pocket. For a limited time, new ExxonMobil smart card holders can save 18 cents a gallon at Exxon and Mobil stations. Subject to credit approval, new account holders can save 18 cents a gallon for their first two billing cycles and 6 cents a gallon each cycle after that. Just use your ExxonMobil smart card to purchase at least 45 gallons in a billing cycle, and you'll receive the rebate on your billing statement for gallons 1 through 100. Get details at ExxonMobilCard.com and learn why more smart drivers choose Exxon and Mobil.
Did you try the new app?
Appetizers. Let's order something. I'm starving.
No, the America's Best Value in iPhone app. Download it from the App Store and make reservations instantly at any of their 1,000 hotels in North America. Most locations have free continental breakfast and internet. Plus, sign up for the Value Club to get 15% off, room upgrade, and late checkout when available.
The America's Best Value in mobile app can do all that?
And more.
Got it. Now, about those appetizers.
Look, kid. Never underestimate janitorial products. Paper towels, trash liners, toilet bowl cleaners, mops. These are the things that hold our civilization together. Janitorial products are the foundation of our fragile world. That's why I use Tough Guy products from Grainger. They're effective and affordable. They're 20% off in July, so stock up. Get it? Got it? Good. Call clickgrainger.com/toughguy or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done. Promotion ends July 31st, 2013. Visit Grainger.com/toughguy for details.
Owe $10,000 or more to the IRS that you can't pay? Call now for immediate help. 866-657-8517. At Community Tax Relief, we help consumers like you. If you take on the IRS alone, you could be facing levies, liens, even wage garnishments, personal or business tax issues. If you owe the IRS $10,000 or more, they will aggressively come after you. Protect yourself and your family today from what the IRS can do to you. Call now. 866-657-8517. They can freeze your bank account, even garnish your wages. Our expert team of tax professionals can solve your tax problems once and for all. Call now for a free 5-minute tax debt analysis. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517.
Geico presents a thank you letter from your motorcycle.
Hi, you dear guy that sits on me. I just wanted to say thanks. Ever since you saved money on your motorcycle insurance with Geico, we've been going out a lot more. The beach, the mountains, that curvy road that leads to the diner with the milkshakes you love. Look, the point is, you and me, we've become a biker buds. And I like it. I like it a lot.
Geico could help you save on your motorcycle insurance, and that should make you and your bike very happy.
PaidAtHome.com won the American Business Award. This is how our listeners are earning from a few hundred to several thousand a month from your kitchen table, even while you sleep. Like listener Nancy, who earned $1,500 month one, saw that jump to $5,000 to now over six figures. Your six-figure income coach will show you how to earn that kind of money from home, too. Hurry, they're giving away $1,000 to someone this year just for checking them out. PaidAtHome.com. PaidAtHome.com. Income not typical. See PaidAtHome.com for income expectation.
Dressed in black, she's a hungry child. No one knows who she is or what her name is.
Today, I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. Peter, that
Hello.
Was so interesting.
Yeah,
listening
very great.
To Dr. Khan Slobodchikoff about animal communication and language. What did you think? Did you hear that?
Yeah, I did hear it. Fascinating. And at the end, when he's talking about what we're learning, there's still more to learn about dog and cat language, and that there's perhaps a lot more in there than we even know is really very intriguing.
Yeah.
So maybe the Google people will come out with a little device that will decode your dog's barks and tell them what they're really saying.
Oh, wouldn't that be cool?
They can, yeah, that'd be great.
Say, bark, get out of my way.
Or get out of my way.
Bark, feed me, or
yes.
Play with me. So are you ready for a quiz?
Yes,
to see how much you know about animal communication?
I am always ready to show my ignorance on radio.
Well, let's start out with, do you know the name of the study of animal communication? What's that called?
The name of the study of animal communication.
What is the study of animal communication called? You're close.
Zoolinguish.
Close. Zoos. Semiotics.
Semiotics.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Zoosemiotics.
Oh.
Okay, I may not be pronouncing it right. Okay, what form of nonverbal communication is used by ants? Visual displays, chemical cues, or scent markings?
What's the difference between chemical and scent? I would say chemical, but it sounds very similar to me.
It's chemical cues to communicate with other ants in their colony. It is similar, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, okay. Some of these questions I got off the internet, so they're not mine. What animals may use bioluminescence to communicate? Fireflies,
yes.
Butterflies, or bats?
Okay, fireflies.
Fireflies. You know, bioluminescence, which is a chemical production and an emission of light. How many honeybees communicate to other... How may honeybees communicate to other bees where the tastiest flowers are?
Oh, I know. They have a dance.
Good.
They shake it.
Good. It's called the waggle dance.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah, I know that.
Honeybees do a little waggle dance to communicate with the other hive members. What has affected the communication between whales? A, increased ocean shipping traffic. B, pollution from ocean shipping. Or C, communication between whales is unaffected by other noise or pollution.
Oh, well, I know A is the biggest
That's
problem,
correct.
Isn't it? Yes.
Yeah, and noise pollution from...
And we've covered that on the show.
We have.
And there's this push to get the cruise ships and the military ships to get out of the way.
Yeah, exactly. And not only affects their communication or their ability to communicate... over long distance, but also ship noise can reduce the ability of whales to find mates, and it confuses the whale sonar, which is important for navigation, as we know.
Right.
Many animals communicate by smells that are released as an airborne chemical called what to send messages to others?
Pheromones?
Yeah, pheromones.
Okay.
Isn't that the little air freshener thing that we bought?
Well, that's one little application of it, but most of them, I think, are just natural.
No, I know.
Everyone claims every men's cologne, you know.
Is a pheromone.
Right.
Well, we bought something from our vet.
Yeah.
You stick in your outlet, and it's supposed to calm your cat.
It's just a method to get money from your bank account to theirs.
Right. Which of the following animals does not use pheromones? Insects, wolves, deer, humans, or all the above use pheromones?
I think all.
Yeah, all of the above. Yeah. Very good. Chimpanzees greet each other by making a sound, bumping chests, or touching hands.
Wow. Sound?
It's touching hands.
Oh, I didn't know.
Like a little hi-fi.
High-five?
Yeah, like a handshake.
Oh.
Yeah. Don't question this. Male fiddler crabs wave their giant claw in order to attract female fiddler crabs, fight off a predator, or to communicate to other crabs that danger is near.
Communicate that danger is near.
No. To attract female fiddler crabs.
So when you were walking along that path,
and a
swarm of them were snapping at you, that was not.
That was to attract me to their nest. I don't know. Okay. True or false? Some fish communicate by grinding their teeth to produce grunting noises that are amplified by an air-filled swim bladder.
Okay, I think that's true.
That is true. Okay, Peter, a neighborhood cat chases chipmunks and squirrels in all the yards on the street except for three. Mm. What is likely going on at those three houses? A, these neighbors have signs up that say no cats allowed. B, the cats only go to homes where owners leave open cans of tuna. Or C, there are other cats living in the house that have marked the yards as their territory.
Oh, C, I would guess.
C is good.
That's okay.
Beluga whales do all the following except snort, whine, chirp, whistle.
Whine?
They don't snort.
They don't snort. I guess that's a nose inhale air sound.
Right.
That would be bad.
What do elephants do with other elephants to show affection?
Okay. You're not going to help me out here with this. Something with the trunks and the...
Yeah, they entwine their trunks.
Wow.
Yeah. How about giraffes? What do giraffes do when they are attracted to each other?
Don't they do a similar thing?
Well, they press their necks together. Exactly.
Press their necks together.
How about horses?
Horses. When they're... Oh, boy. You tell me.
They rub their noses together.
Yeah, I don't spend a lot of time with horses. I'm just not really a horse.
Well, they're not attracted to you. They're attracted to other horses. True or false, gorillas show anger by sticking out their tongues.
Oh, gorillas stick out their tongue. Well, I would say yes.
That is true.
Wow.
Perhaps the most famous example in recent decades has been Coco, a gorilla who is supposedly able to communicate with humans using a system based on what? With the vocabulary of over 1,000
Coco
words.
Coco is the American Sign Language? And
very good.
Yeah, yeah.
Coco. Very good.
Yeah.
Okay, just a few more here. Ants know which path to choose to find food because previous members of their colony have left pheromones to mark unrewarding trails. They can smell food down the correct path. They are pushed by ants behind them in the right direction. They have incredible memories.
Oh, how about the first one?
Very good.
What was that?
Previous members of the colony have left pheromones to mark unrewarding trails.
Don't go here. That's interesting. Don't go here.
That's right. Wow. One more.
All right.
Okay, true or false? Dogs can study the expressions of their guardians to differentiate when humans mean business or are ready to engage in some fun.
Oh, that's got to be true.
If that's true.
Not true, I'm just wasting a lot of time here.
Right. That is true.
Okay.
Very good. You did good.
Well, thank you. Some challenges in there. And I want to tell everyone that in our home animal pet products laboratory, we have been doing a demo and a test run of a great product from Enchanted Home Pet, and we have their product, which they call the Ultra Plush Club Chair. And it's basically a dog or a pet bed, but it looks like a club chair. And it's sort of this low slung thing. It looks like a swanky piece of furniture. And it's synthetic, and it looks really cute. And so
it's adorable.
It is adorable. And it is constructed. It's just not a floppy little pillow. It's actually like constructed like a chair with sides and feet and a back. And we deployed this thing, took it out of this box. We received a large example of this, and put it out in the living room. And in a couple of sniffs later, Susie jumps on there and just settles in there nicely. So she fits beautifully in there, likes it.
And then when she really left, cute. One
she
of our
left,
cats jumped in there and
the
cats, tried to claim it.
Yeah, so the cat and the cat likes it a lot. It's definitely dwarfs the cat, right? But and this company, Enchanted Home Pet, they make a whole line of different styles. So if you care about the decor in your house, you can probably find a style that they make. So check them out, ehpet.net.
Very good.
All right.
Okay, we have some news after the break, right?
Yeah, news coming
up. Okay, good. All right. Don't go away. This is Dr. Lori Kircher, and you're listening to Animals Today. Come on, that's all right.
That's the sound of a dog whose vocal cords were cut just to stifle her voice. It's called devocalization, and it's done to cats as well. Devocalized animals rasp and wheeze, cough and gag the rest of their lives. Some are rendered mute. And for what? So a commercial or hobby breeder can keep many animals without having to listen to them. So show dogs will be quiet in transit between shows or in the ring. So an irresponsible pet owner can leave a dog alone for hours every day. Animals today joins with Coalition to Protect and Rescue Pets in saying shame on anyone who would have a dog or cat devocalized, and shame on the vets who perform this inhumane, unnecessary surgery for them. Please speak out against devocalization of dogs and cats. Use your voice. Protect theirs.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. Can check them out at AIAnimals.org.
PaidAtHome.com won the American Business Award. This is how our listeners are earning from a few hundred to several thousand a month from your kitchen table, even while you sleep. Like listener Nancy, who earned $1,500 month one, saw that jump to $5,000 to now over six figures. Your six-figure income coach will show you how to earn that kind of money from home, too. Hurry, they're giving away $1,000 to someone this year just for checking them out. PaidAtHome.com. PaidAtHome.com. Income not typical. See paidathome.com for income expectation.
The mills were overstocked, so they came to us. We struck incredible deals on incredible floors, and we're passing the deals on to you at Lumber Liquidators Overstock Flooring Sale. All bamboo is on sale for $1.49 a square foot. Get laminate flooring from 49 cents, and our best laminates up to 33% off. Pre-finished hardwood is up to 40% off our incredibly low prices, plus special extended financing. Overstock Flooring Sale is going on now. Get to LumberLiquidators.com or your local store for your big deal today.
Have you heard? Proactive is America's top acne system because it's fast and gentle, and it's all about prevention. So stay tuned for a chance to participate in a 60-day trial to prove it. Do you have troubled skin, acne? With Proactive, you can heal your acne and help prevent new breakouts. Right now, in this radio area, we're looking for just 50 people with moderate acne to demonstrate exactly how fast Proactive works. The first 50 callers who qualify can try Proactive risk-free for 60 days. And you get our dermatologist's clear skin or it's free guarantee. Plus, the trial includes our legendary refining mask and green tea moisturizer free. Be one of the 50 lucky people to complete this 60-day risk-free trial. You won't see this offer in stores or on TV. It's a radio exclusive. Supplies are limited and the trial offer ends soon. So call now. 1-800-569-4918. That's 1-800-569-4918. 1-800-569-4918.
Ah, the sweet sound of money in your pocket. For a limited time, new Exxon Mobil smart card holders can save 18 cents a gallon at Exxon and Mobil stations. Subject to credit approval, new account holders can save 18 cents a gallon for their first two billing cycles and 6 cents a gallon each cycle after that. Just use your Exxon Mobil smart card to purchase at least 45 gallons in a billing cycle, and you'll receive the rebate on your billing statement for gallons 1 through 100. Get details at ExxonMobilCard.com and learn why more smart drivers choose Exxon and Mobil.
If you're struggling to pay or haven't been making your student loan payments, listen carefully to this urgent alert. Have you been out of school for 10 or more years and you're still making your student loan payments? Are your student loans past due or even in default? Can't go back to school because of an old student loan problem? Fast Track Student Loans can get your student loans out of default, stop any wage garnishments, stop collection calls, and stop seizure of your tax refund. Give yourself a break. Stop the stress and get your student loan payments down to as little as $25 a month based on what you can afford to pay. One quick 10-minute call could help you solve your student loan problems. So call right now. Not available in all states. Payments may vary based on income.
800-685-0129. 800-685-0129. 800-685-0129. That's 800-685-0129.
If you're a Medicare member with diabetes, you may be confused over recent changes affecting where you can buy test strips. Don't worry. CVS Pharmacy continues to accept Medicare Part B coverage for diabetes testing supplies. Our stores carry all major brands and offer a 90-day supply at the same low Medicare copay as mail order.
You may even qualify for a free OneTouch or CVS brand meter from the manufacturer. So stop by your local CVS pharmacy today.
Welcome back to Animals Today. Hello, Peter.
Hey, Lori. How are you doing?
Good. What's in the news these days?
Well, you know, a good story in the Excelsior Youth Center in Spokane. There, this is a teen center there in therapy for drug and alcohol abuse. Well, they've studied the experience of bringing dogs into the facility and using them as interacting with the young men. And they find the teens who spent time with dogs, they were more joyful, had improved attentiveness and serenity. And also the symptoms for ADHD, depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder decreased dramatically.
Wow.
So this is more a science. This is actually performed by a PhD candidate. So this is a real stuff going on here, just confirming sort of what we know. It's sort of snowballing, isn't it?
It sure is.
Yeah.
It doesn't surprise me.
A recent poll about our attitudes and behaviors concerning pets of 603 registered voters by telephone. Do you know that 21% rated snakes as the most terrifying animal?
That does not surprise me.
I had a snake encounter the other day.
I know you did.
And that was, you know, we're in the desert, and we had a pretty long snake right in our driveway. It was really hot. It was
like 2 feet long.
18 degrees.
Yeah, it was hot. Yeah.
And I'm not really into snakes. Like, you know, I respect them. I just don't want to be around them, you know?
You love all animals.
And I was able to pick up this snake with a pole and coax it into a box and then released it out in the desert. And
that was very nice of you.
I don't think I was in danger. I really don't think it's a poisonous snake or anything. And he was not interested in looking at me. But it got me excited.
Yeah.
In a scary kind of way, I have to say.
Well, when it's 6 feet from your front door.
Yeah, well, that's the thing.
Yeah.
So other animals that are frightened people in this survey are alligators. 19% of people thought it was the most terrifying. Sharks and bears, 18% and 14%. And in this survey, you know, 52% of the respondents preferred dogs as their pet. 21% cats. And a bunch didn't know which they liked better. So interesting stuff. Vegetarian or vegan was claimed by 9%. 9% of the respondents said they were vegan or vegetarian, which I think is pretty high.
Wow, that is high.
On the other hand, 18% believe the Loch Ness Monster is real.
Okay.
That's sort of high also. What do you think about old Nessie there?
Yeah.
Do you think it's a real animal hiding down there, or like a hoax or an illusion?
I think it might be an illusion slash hoax.
Yeah. Well, I think...
What do you think?
I'm open to that.
Really?
Yeah, the voices in my head tell me it could be happening.
Okay.
So I don't know.
Okay.
You know, cats, you know, people get the feeling that their cats are ignoring them. You know, do cats really interact with you? Something.
Our cats tend to ignore us. They're very aloof. They're very... Just, I'm queen of the house here.
Yes. Well, it turns out that cats do pay attention to the voices of their guardians more than strange voices. So in this study that was conducted in the home of the actual cat, you've got recorded voices. The cats couldn't see the speakers from where they're emanating. And if the cat heard a stranger, it really wouldn't orient towards that voice as much as if the owner's voice was coming out.
Right.
So they would turn their ears and move their head toward the source of the voice.
Right.
And they also dilated their pupils more toward their guardians than strangers.
Meaning excited.
They know, that's right, more excited. So they know who you are.
Yeah.
And they sort of are, they're just taking on, they know who you are. Maybe they are ignoring you.
That's why you hear me once in a while say, hi, Margarita. Hi, Margarita.
Yes.
And I see your little ears twitch towards me. She likes that.
She likes it. That's the, that is the ears trying to close themselves off. You know, the new exotic animal law in Ohio, which after the tragedy, is now in effect, but it's being fought by the owners of some of these exotic animals. They're claiming on constitutional grounds that the law violates the First and Fifth Amendments by limiting their freedom of association and effectively taking their property. So that is going to the U.S. Circuit Appeals Court, and we'll see what happens with that. I don't think they have much of a case, to tell you the truth.
Right.
And they just they do have options. They're claiming we have no options, but they can join the zoological associations, or they can apply for wildlife shelter permits. They can keep these animals if they want.
Right.
They just don't want to deal.
Right. They don't want to deal.
This is their final thing here. And then I want to tell you that in India has just banned animal testing on all cosmetics.
Fantastic news.
Yes. So that is still a lot of other countries that have to get on the bandwagon here. The EU has done this.
Right.
We covered that a few months ago. Israel also. But that's pretty much it.
Yeah.
So we're still working on all those
other
countries.
But this is good. This is a big step.
Yes, it is a step. And so congratulations to India and all those who fought for that. And another tragedy witnessed by rare bird enthusiasts off the coast of Scotland. They were watching this very unusual sighting of the white-throated needletail, which is a bird, and this can reach up to 105 miles an hour in level flight, so it's like the fastest bird that way. And it was off the coast. It really doesn't belong there. It's rarely sighted in that part of the world.
And there's only like 20 or 30 left, right?
There are a few scores left, that's
okay.
Right.
Okay.
And so this bird was just putting on a great show, and for 2 hours the birders were watching this rare bird in flight, and then what happened? It crashed into the blades of a wind turbine.
Oh, no.
Wind turbine,
yeah.
And was instantly killed.
Oh, my goodness.
So,
you know, I heard this story when I was listening to Rush the other day.
Really?
And I really didn't appreciate how he handled the story.
What did he do?
Oh, he just sort of, he really didn't. I'm not going to say he mocked it or made fun of it, but I think he had his own reasons by putting this on, how maybe it's a little ridiculous thing.
Yeah.
But I don't know. That was my interpretation. I just didn't appreciate the way he handled it. I love Rush, but I didn't appreciate how he handled this one.
It's a real tragedy.
Yeah.
For the bird, but it shows there's the innate conflicts.
Yeah.
In our world. What do you do?
This is Dr. Lori Kirshner encouraging you to nurture your love and compassion for the only other being sharing our planet, the animals.
The opinions you hear on the Business Talk Radio Network are those of the host, callers, and guests, and not necessarily those of this station, Business Talk Radio Network, its management, or advertisers. The information on the Business Talk Radio Network does not constitute a recommendation, offer, or solicitation to buy or sell any product or securities. Investing involves risks, so please consult a professional before investing. If you have any questions or comments about the Business Talk Radio Network, contact us at 203-323-7300 or at our website, businesstalkradio.net.
IRN USA Radio News. I'm Cameron Swayze. At least one teenager is listed in critical condition Sunday after a bus returning from a church summer camp crashed off of an Indianapolis interstate. Three people are dead, 19 others are injured. An investigation began into what caused the accident, which happened when the bus was just minutes away from the end of its journey. 37 passengers are on board the bus when it overturned Saturday afternoon, just about a mile from the Colonial Hills Baptist Church where the bus was headed. The pilot of a speedboat that crashed into a barge on the Hudson River while carrying six members of a wedding party, including the bride-to-be, charged over the weekend with vehicular manslaughter. Jojo John also charged with three counts of vehicular assault following Friday night's crash. He remains in a hospital. This is IRN USA Radio News.
When you booked with Booking.com, did you expect this? Somewhere 10 times better than anywhere you've ever lived or will ever live.
Chic.
Look at the Booking pool. You don't have a pool. You don't even have a bath.
French stuff.
Spin around in the spaciousness that's not your 32-square-foot apartment because you have arrived.
Helicopter.
In your dream getaway, which you chose from over 300,000 properties on planet Earth's number one accommodation site, Booking.com. Booking.yeah.
If you came to Sears, I'd show you a Kenmore Elite French Door refrigerator with 33 cubic feet of storage capacity. No other fridge holds more. Isn't that right, Gargantua?
Gargantua love big shiny box. Hold 50 pterodactyl wings. Gargantua love pterodactyl wings.
It's a giant, all right. And you can also get an extra 15% off all appliances over $4.99 when you use your Sears card.
One appliance store helps more people with savings and solutions than any other. This is Sears. Exclusions apply. See store for details. Offer valid 7/28/23.
In another blow to Anthony Weiner's beleaguered campaign to become mayor of New York City, his campaign manager quits on Saturday. Danny Kenham, a 30-year-old who oversaw Weiner's candidacy as the disgraced former congressman, moved from long shot to real contender, told Weiner he could no longer manage his campaign after new revelations about Weiner's online contact with women over the last week. The New York Times was the first to report the story. Retired Colonel George Bud Day, a Medal of Honor recipient who spent 5.5 years as a POW in Vietnam and was Arizona Senator John McCain's cellmate, died at the age of 88 on Sunday, according to his widow. Day, one of the nation's most highly decorated servicemen since General Douglas MacArthur and later a tireless advocate for veterans' rights, died surrounded by family at his home in Chalamar after a long illness. This is IRN USA Radio Network News.
If you're a Medicare member with diabetes, you may be confused over recent changes affecting where you can buy test strips. Don't worry. CVS Pharmacy continues to accept Medicare Part B coverage for diabetes testing supplies. Our stores carry all major brands and offer a 90-day supply at the same low Medicare copay as mail order. You may even qualify for a free one-touch or CVS brand meter from the manufacturer. So stop by your local CVS pharmacy today.
U.S.